Development is one activity we are going to insert here. So we are trying to collect the recordings of the webinar, PPTs or PDFs, whatever we can get. And we are trying to host that on our website so that anyone who has missed out on any lecture can come and join and have a look at them and can increase their information and knowledge. Second, we have already hosted manuals. Manuals which were developed by it was developed by committees which were formed by Professor Sri Rama Rao in 2014. So during that period, these committees interacted and came up with the special publications and manuals which we are already having on our website, and they are very useful, I will tell. So all these things are going to enhance the value of our website, and it will be tremendously useful for everyone who is interested in geotechnical engineering. Second is we have already scanned all the old journal right from I think 1967 or so, if I recall correctly, and also some important conferences we have already scanned them, and we have converted them in a searchable format. And so now we are going to host our old journal on our website. So you can go, and if you type some name or search information, you will get the information on the old journal, old knowledge, and you know old is gold. So what you can get the conceptually in the old journal, probably you may not be even able to get in the new journal. So that is the second thing we are going to develop on our website. And the third thing is to the professionals, we are trying to interact a lot with the professional. We are trying to involve, because we have in the past have been, it is our experience that most of the time, it is the academicians or students mostly. So unless we have the professional content in our geotechnical society, it would be really difficult. So what we are trying to do is bringing the professional, more and more professional to our fold. And for that, in the yesterday's newsletter itself, we have announced 4 new awards exclusively for professionals, and we have called for nomination. And these 4 new awards have been instituted presently by IGS from their own fund, but if sponsors can come for these awards, it will be great. And we are also hosted the company informations, which is members of IG, Indian Geotechnical Society, and also forum for professionals has been established on our website. And the fourth point I want to say that we are emphasizing a lot about the testing, and we have done the MOU with the NABL. We have also combined IGS and NABL, and we are coming with the guidelines so that if you want accreditation, then NABL IGS accreditation will be there henceforth. So that is how the development is taking place. So far it has not fully materialized, but soon it will be materialized. So these are some of the developments that I wanted to tell you in this brief duration. And with this, I thanks the organizers for giving me this opportunity, and to Professor Rama Rao for inviting me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sahu Garu, for your valuable remarks and regarding some developments taken by IGS. Now,
thank you,
sir. Before inviting the family members of Professor Sri Ramarao Garu to address, I once again express our heartfelt thanks to Srimati Jyoti Garu, Niharika Garu, for your presence on this occasion. Thank you. And I invite Niharika Garu to speak.
My name is Niharika. I would just like to introduce myself briefly. And whenever I do that, the first thing that comes to my mind is daughter of Professor Sri Rama Rao. So I'm here representing all the family members, and that includes my mother, Srimati Jyoti Ajjarappu, and my brother, Ajjarappu Suhas. He's also present here in the meeting, and I'm talking on behalf of all of us here. I think it's a wonderful gesture, and my warm greetings on behalf of all the family members to Professor Sivakumar Babu Garu, who I've met and interacted with and who knows my mother personally, Professor Sahu, Professor V.S. Rajagaru, and Engineer Brahmayya Garu, and of course, special thanks and greetings to M. Ramarao Garu, who has been instrumental in driving this commemorative seminar year after year. It's been the third year now, and hats off to his commitment levels and the way he's been taking this forward. We attended the first meeting in Guntur a couple of years back, and unfortunately we missed the last meeting, which was held last year. And this year, owing to the pandemic situation, we are meeting online, all of us. I think it's both a blessing and a bane. We cannot meet in person, but I think this has facilitated a lot of participants to actively participate in this event and this seminar. A lot of people have spoken and will be speaking perhaps about my father as a professional, but I would just like to share that personally too, he was a wonderful human being, and he showed us by example how a good life ought to be lived. He was a complete family man. He gave a lot of time to his family members, and adored by his siblings, admired by his students, and his everybody's favorite in the family. Whatever I and my brother are today, I think we owe a lot to what our father has given us. So I remember the first time I spoke in Guntur, I got very emotional and broke down on the dais itself, completely ignoring the fact that I'm facing an audience and it was a large seminar hall. And today also, I'm kind of getting a little emotional, but that's the kind of person that my father was. It's difficult to believe that it's been 3 years now, and and whatever we are doing in life and what are we enjoying in life, thanks to our father and my mother. And my mother, she would like to speak, but she's not very comfortable speaking, so I'm doing it on her behalf. She would like to thank all the organizers, IGS Guntur chapters specifically, because they've been putting in a lot of effort. I know what it takes to have a seminar like this online, all the arrangements that go into it. By the way, I'm into teaching profession too. So I understand what goes behind organizing a seminar of this size and stature. So thanks to all the dignitaries who are present here. A warm thank you from all of us to all the participants who have taken time out to attend this seminar, and hope there's a great learning for all the participants too. I'm not a civil engineer by profession, but my mother is, and my brother is a physiotherapist. So we've taken different paths, and one final thank you, highly indebted to Guntur chapter, IGS chapter, and Professor Ramarao Garu, and all those dignitaries present here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Niharik Garu. Now, before starting the lecture, I invite Mr. P.V.S. Maruti Krishna Garu, Associate Professor, RVR and JC College of Engineering, Guntur, to introduce Professor V.S. Rajagaru on this occasion. Maruti Krishna Garu.
Maruti Krishna Garu.
Hello.
Hello.
Maruti Krishna Garu, please introduce Professor V.S. Raju Garu to the participants.
Okay, sir. So, good morning, one and all. I am happy and delighted to invite Professor V.S. Raju formerly Director IIT Delhi, Professor and Dean IIT Madras. Professor V.S. Raju obtained his bachelor's in civil engineering from Andhra University, master's in geotechnical engineering from Indian Institute of Science, and a doctor of engineering from University of Karlsruhe, Germany. He was also senior fellow of Alexander von Humboldt Foundation. V.S. Raju was the director of IIT Delhi during 1995-2000. During his academic career of 42 years, his other responsibilities include member part-time, TRAI India, professor, head and dean at IIT Madras between 1970 to 1994 and 2000 to 2003. He was extensively involved in academic, sponsored research and consultancy. He was also chairman, Novel Research Board, Chairman Research Council CRRI, and member of several boards and committees dealing with technical education and research in the country. He is a fellow of the Indian National Academy of Engineering and was its honorary secretary. The Federal Republic Germany honored him with the Commander's Cross, the highest award given to a foreigner. He was also on the board of companies including Arati Airtel, Nagarjuna Construction Company, and Sachin Computer Services. Dr. Raju did extensive R&D work in the areas of such as liquefaction of saturated sands, behavior of vesicular laterites, piles founded in weak rocks, performance and monitoring of structures, ocean energy. He is a very active foundation consultant, benefiting over 650 projects such as power station, fertilizers and petrochemical projects, port structures, dams, buildings all over India and abroad. In the last 7 years, extended foundation consultancy for about 100 gated community projects, essentially high-rise towers in the national capital region. Out of them, for about 20 projects, piled raft foundations have been adopted. He continues to be very active as foundation consultant and as an advisor to several new educational institutions. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Maruti Krishna Garu. Now I request Professor V.S. Raju Garu to start the lecture.
Namaste to all of you. I am delighted to be here today and to share with you some of my thoughts. First, it's an honor to deliver this lecture as a tribute to Professor Sri Rama Rao. Apart from all the achievements and his academic contributions, which have already been highlighted, it's not a small thing for somebody from Kakinada to become the president of IGS. You know, mostly it is the bigger cities that are normally in the limelight. And also as president of IGS, in addition to what has already been told, he has also constituted several committees, I think 10 of them, to come out with recommendations so that the quality of geotechnical engineering practice in the country could be enhanced. One of these committees were geotechnical investigations. And I had the privilege of chairing that group and then come out with certain recommendations. This is also a great day. That is Mahatma Gandhi's birthday. Of course, we all cherish that. And also Karl Terzaghi's birthday. I was not really aware of it before. Anyway, now I have come to know of that. Professor Babu has already said about Terzaghi's visit to Polavaram site. So I'm also aware of it. As students, we used to hear that he visited the Polavaram site. Maybe some of you know that at that point of time, the discussion was between Polavaram Dam and Nagarjuna Sagar Dam. So Polavaram could not be executed at that time because at Polavaram, we have 100 meter thick sand layer. And there was no technology available at that time to make this sand layer impervious, either through open excavation or through a diaphragm wall. Of course, now we have the technology and the diaphragm wall has already been installed. I am also privileged to associate myself with the Polavaram project with some of the design aspects. So then I would also like to thank and compliment the Guntur chapter. It's really amazing, you know, from Guntur, you know, to organize so many programs. And that too, also think of this annual lecture in honor of Professor Sri Rama Rao. So hats off to all of you, to Dr. Mobal Rama Rao and all the other people associated with the Guntur chapter. So this is also not a very common thing to give a talk through webinar or whatever it is called, you know, through this online because of the prevailing situation. But I think it seems to be work quite well. Only I hope that the power will not go off in the middle, and then that will be a problem. So I think, so once again, my compliments and thanks to Guntur chapter. So Professor Mobal Rama Rao, can I start with the presentation?
Yes, sir, you can please share your screen, sir.
Yes, I'll do that. First video mute, share screen. Yes. And I think I would double click that here. Share. Is it clearly visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So once again, my greetings to all the participants for this lecture and welcome you. I think this lecture contains quite a bit of information, so you may find it slightly overwhelming. What I suggest is, because you have all these PowerPoint presentations with you already, later you can go through that, and then I forgot to put my email here, but I think that can be shared. And if you have any doubts or clarifications, you can send me a mail and I'll try to respond to that. And then, see, normally we have two options for a foundation, either a raft for especially high-rise towers or a pile foundation. But as compared to a pile foundation, if you go for a pile-assisted raft, we have a major advantage of substantial reduction in number of piles, which in turn results in savings of cost and time. Both are important. Cost is important and time is also important. It is also some extent removes uncertainties associated with board piles and driven cast in suitable piles. Unfortunately, we have a lot of problems with board piles in alluvial soils. For example, in one of the recent past, it is stunning. Only about 25% of the piles are in good health based on pile integrity tests. You can imagine the trauma that if you have a situation like that. I've already mentioned about this, the conventional pile design methodology. We neglect the pile caps and rafts. We have to increase the number of piles or length of piles. Very small allowable settlement. Pile factor of safety is approximately 2. On the other hand, pile raft design method, raft is the main bearing element. Designed for full utilization of pile capacity, that means factor of safety is either can be equal to 1 or slightly more than 1. Piles are settlement reducers. The purpose of the piles is to reduce it. Then you can also consider optimum allocation of piles to decrease the differential settlement and bending moment of raft. A very good reference to this pile raft is the Pile Raft Foundation for the Burj Dubai Design and Performance, IGS Ferroco Terzaghi Oration 2008 by Professor Harry Paulus. I'm sure this is easily accessible to all of you. I encourage you to go through that presentation. Here I have shown the load settlement behavior. So if you go for a raft foundation, the buildup of load is gradual and you can go for up to larger settlements. Whereas in case of piles, it is just very quickly the load is mobilized and then afterwards it becomes constant, or the ultimate situation will be reached fairly early as far as settlements are concerned. I've highlighted the steps involved in pile wrap design. I won't go through everything. First is the estimate the safe bearing capacity of raft from shear consideration. Normally, rafts in alluvial soils have huge bearing capacities. So bearing capacity is never a consideration. If you see the bottom line, I've written here, for a raft size of 20 meters by 20 meters, SPC will be in the range of 75 to 125 tons per meter square, which is very, very large. So the only issue will be the settlements. So the next step is we calculate the settlements, assuming that there are no piles. So if the settlements are within the permissible limits, and what these limits are, we'll see in the slide 22, then a raft foundation will suffice. On the other hand, step three, the settlements are exceeding the permissible values, the piles are provided to act as settlement reducers. So you estimate the number of piles so that the settlements of the pile raft foundation system are less than the permissible values. As I already said, you can use the ultimate capacity of the pile. Step four is then the load shared by the piles and the rafts are estimated. The load coming on the raft will be shared by raft, directly transferring to soil layer below, and the piles, which will transfer the load to soil through skin friction and end bearing. The load sharing naturally depends on relative stiffness of piles and soil support to the raft. So I've just given a figure here how to estimate the settlements due to load on piles. So that standard procedure in alluvia, we take 30% as end bearing and 70% friction acting at one third the length of the pile from the bottom. So I think all of you know this. Then you estimate the settlements of the raft due to the load shared by the raft. Then the total settlements will be contribution of the raft plus contribution of piles. And this should be less than the permissible settlement. Then the subgrade modulus is the gross bearing pressure on raft by total raft settlement. In reality, it should be net bearing pressure. But the structural engineers in the structural analysis, they use the gross bearing pressure. So taking that into account, we give it as the gross bearing pressure divided by raft settlement. Then this explains the structural analysis. Then at the bottom, you see pile springs. Up to 4 to 6 centimeter settlement, we take it as ultimate load divided by four to six in kilograms per centimeter. And if the settlements exceed the value 4 or 6 centimeters, you replace the springs with ultimate capacity of the pile PU. This is the real challenge. The challenge is determination of soil modulus ES to estimate settlements and with it the subgrade modulus K. Normally, ES is determined by correlating with SPT N value, most commonly used. Static cone penetration value, you convert the static cone penetration value to SPT and then take the correlation. Of course, for shallow depths, you can use footing or plate load test. Of course, there's another option which I have not mentioned here, that is the pressure meter test. But that is a little complicated. It's normally not done. But right now, we have done extensive pressure meter tests for the new nuclear power plant, which is coming in Haryana in alluvium. There, of course, a lot of pressure meter tests have been done, and then they have been compared with the correlations with the SPT value and all that, maybe in some other presentation that will be presented. Here is the challenge. So normally the standard book all of you look at is Bowles, and he gives sand ES value 500 into n plus 15, silty sand 300 into n plus 16, like that. You go on getting all sorts of values. Then the latest Japanese code gives a much higher value, 2600 to 2900 times n. Correlation which we personally like very much is by Schulze and Moose. And in the graph, you can see N value versus soil modulus ES. And we have been using this graph for the last 40 years or so. Maybe my German experience has prompted me to do this. For example, if you have an SPT N is equal to 40, the soil modulus comes to 730 kilograms per centimeter square. In IAS 8009-1976, reaffirmed 1998, there is a correlation. You can see the graph. I hope it is clear to you. For N is equal to 40, and if the overburden pressure is zero, that means near the surface, EV is 800 kilograms per centimeter square. On the other hand, if you go to overburden pressure of 1.5 kilograms per centimeter square, EV reduces to half. That's not very clear to me, actually, why the EV should reduce when you go deeper. That means higher overburden pressure is, you are going deeper. In my opinion, this should not be the case. Of course, the soil modulus can also be determined by the footing load test or plate load test. The standard equation, you already know that. I don't want to read it here. So that's the ES is a function of the load applied and then the foundation and the efficiency factors and all that. Once you have the soil modulus, the settlement is the standard equation, the thickness of the layer, increase in stress on the layer divided by the soil modulus. For the field determination, we did some footing load tests for the Delhi International Airport, you know, which is also an alluvium. Of course, there at shallow level itself, the N values are good. So for example, here we have SPT N value 50, and we get at the, you can read it little lower, ES equals almost 1119 kilograms per centimeter square. After Shulja Moose, it comes to 800. So that means the Shulja Moose is still conservative by a factor 1.4. The second footing load test, where the N value is somewhat lower, it is only 22. Here the soil modulus works out to 787. And ES, according to Shulja Moose, comes to 530. The ratio is 1.48. It's interesting. In both the cases, the ratio is coming the same. That means even the Shulja Moose correlation, which is based on actual settlement observations, is also conservative. Also because it is done quite some time back also. Those days, they were not anticipating such high-rise buildings and all. So I have given the summary here for both the cases. For 50 bowls, you can see, so low value it gives, 325. IS gives 820. Shulja moves 800. Japanese code 1300. Footing load test 1100. In the second case also, comparable values are coming. But as I said, IS, if you go to lower levels, it is giving lower values. So in other words, my message is, depending upon what soil modulus you choose, you end up with a highly varying settlements. They can vary by a factor 2, 3. Then you are lost because you have a limited permissible settlement. And depending upon what you calculate, you will conclude whether the raft is okay, not okay. See, before I go to the next slide, I want to share with you a very important thing. See, safety comes first. We should never compromise on safety. You know, that's very, very clear. That cannot be compromised. But at the same time, economy is also very important. If you go for uneconomical solutions, then it will cost not only money, but a lot of time. Just give me this example of Terminal T3 at the New Delhi airport. So I'm sure most of you have traveled through Terminal T3. GMR, who are the owners of the airport, gave contract to L&T for Terminal T3 with a pile foundation. Argument given, geotechnical investigation report recommends piles. And also Terminal T1, which is a small terminal, is on piles. So Terminal T3 has to be on piles. I have been consulting to L&T for more than 40 years. So when it came to me for review, I immediately told them, look, this is really crazy and the soil is so good here, you don't need any piles for the Terminal T3. And then it involved a lot of convincing and a lot of testing, footing load test also. Finally, there is not a single pile under Terminal T3. They saved 6 months of construction time. And imagine on 12,000 crores of investment, if you save 6 months of construction time on 12,000 crores, then what saving you get? And then if Delhi gets its airport 6 months ahead of time, what is the benefit for Delhi? And what is the benefit for the nation? So this is the issue. But at the same time, you have to be sure. So I asked them to monitor the settlements of the rafts for Terminal T3. And they monitored the settlements. They were not at all significant. Now, permissible settlements, as per IS 1904-1986, RAF Foundation 75 mm, which is relatively low. But anyway, once you do these public projects, you have to satisfy the codal requirement. Till you change the code, you cannot adopt a higher permissible RAF. But as per IS 16700, the latest code on tall structures, settlements up to 125 mm are allowed, subject to rotation in superstructure and also the raft limited to 1 in 500. So if you satisfy this 1 in 500 criteria for tall structures, you can go up to 125 millimeters. There are some very interesting observations. Actually, this concept of pile rafts evolved simultaneously, I think mostly in Germany and later also US and elsewhere, around 2000 or so. For example, you can see this tower, don't worry about the name, the tower which is first tower, 130 meters high on pile raft, it's actually 150 millimeters, then there are no problem. In the next one, 144 millimeters. This is a 256 meter tall tower, 208 meters tower, like that. So there is one more on that. Okay. So anyway, I don't want to spend time on this. You can read it later. The tallest structure in the world, Burj Khalifa, is also on pile-assisted raft. I told you, the Paulus paper, you can read that. This is a 160-story tower. This is founded on a 3.7-meter thick raft, supported on board piles, 1.5 meter diameter, 50 meters long. The estimated total settlement is 45 mm to 75 mm. Settlements under dead load, 43 mm, they were measured already. Extrapolated to full load is 55 to 60 mm. So therefore, predictions are fairly accurate. We did a pile-assisted raft for a 51-story tower at Gurgaon with two basements. The strata is predominantly sandy silt with water table 25 meters below ground level. That is an advantage. So founding level is 12 meters below ground level. Below founding level, N values are 35 and above. This is the tower that has been completed, almost nearing completion. I don't have the latest picture after full completion. See, here comes your ingenuity and application of mine. So originally, this was done by a Singapore consultant. He recommended a pile raft of size 54 meters by 68 meters. With 600 mm dia board piles of varying lengths, total number of piles 345. And the client wanted to restrict the settlements to 50 mm. Though the code allowed 75, they said, no, we want only 50 mm. That came to review to us, and we did some additional boreholes and did a fresh assessment. We reduced the raft area by 50%. You can see that number. The board piles were 600 mm diameter and 18 meters long. Reduction in number of piles is 70%. Imagine. The settlements are still restricted to 50 mm. Approximately 25% of the total load will be transferred to the piles. Then the rest of it is clear. Piles are designed for ultimate capacity. Settlement observations were monitored at 5 points on the raft. And as of September 2016, 50 floors are completed. Very surprisingly, they observed only settlements of 20 mm. So we were talking about more like up to 50. So 20 mm, I feel it's on the lower side, but we have no way of checking. And also what happens is the settlements or observations need a lot of dedication. Now, after some time, people lose interest and then they're busy with the construction and so many things are happening. So this is the first time adoption of pile draft in India, as far as we know. Similarly, the Project Delhi one, we have a lot of details and we also did pile estate draft for residential towers and draft foundations for the rest. This is an artistic view of. See, everywhere we tell them mandatory for you to observe the settlements. Some people follow, some don't follow, some communicate, some won't. As this I've already mentioned to you, examples in Delhi region, settlements of drafts. Dial terminal 3 on draft, settlement measured and reported is not significant. So it's a non-issue, but I don't have the exact figure. The same problem. They said that they started measuring the settlements. After some time, they found that there were no further settlements and it was discontinued. This is a 30-story structure in Gurgaon. Two basements for 30 floors on draft. Dead load settlements were 26 mm and estimated total settlement 40 mm. To my knowledge, I think this is the first structure which is on a raft. 30-story structure on raft, I think this is the first one, as far as I know, in Delhi, National Capital Region. Six further settlements are being carried out on 6 structures, but as I said, the challenge is always to get the data. One structure in Noida is fully instrumented, where load on the piles, reactions of the base raft and the settlements are being measured, but I don't have the data. But this has been done in Germany extensively. Very meticulously, they have done these measurements on structures. You know, I've shown you some slides earlier giving the settlement value. We need a number of settlement observations. There are different methods, of course, but simplest is any precision leveling instrument will be okay. Fixed plates on the floor or to the columns. Basement is ideal. But ground floor also is okay, because ground floor means the settlements of the basement weights are already over. But there could be other sophisticated techniques of measuring settlements, but I feel in the Indian context, this is the simplest. Okay. But execution is also very important. Flooding of the excavation from surface water during monsoon to be avoided. Very important. This can be done by proper bunding and sandbagging around the excavation and providing surface drainage away from the excavation. These are simple things. But very often we notice that people have not bothered about it and then the flood will come. The worst still, some of the investigating agencies recommend flooding the excavation before placing the raft, which is an absurd recommendation. So after I've tried, advised a couple of people, no, you cannot do that. That's the wrong way of doing it. It is only meant for very loose sands. And if you don't have any compaction equipment, the one way of improving the loose sand density to medium density is by flooding. But that doesn't mean that everywhere you start flooding. The last 50 centimeter of excavation should be done just prior to placement of the mud mat, so that you are not putting the mud mat on a disturbed soil. The excavated surface should be thoroughly compacted. See, if you don't do that, what happens is the settlements of the top layers themselves will be more than the total settlement. So for rafts, you have to use heavy-duty vibratory roller or plate vibrators. For pile-estate rafts, heavy-duty plate vibrator, which passes in between the piles. Flooding should not be used for compaction. I already said this. For dust control, if required, water sprinkling can be done. In some cases, it is desirable to place 125 mm thick soling stones on the compacted surface. The soling stone should be well compacted. So the mud mat will come on the soling stones. This is very, very crucial and very critical. In case of high groundwater table, because some places in Alluvia, you have high water table, maybe 5 meters, 6 meters. And your founding level sometimes could be as deep as 20 meters. So that means you have to excavate 15 meters below water table. This is the big challenge. Prior to the excavation, groundwater table has to be lowered to 1 meter below the bottom of the excavation. This level has to be maintained till the foundations are cast. That is very critical. That's very difficult also. If you don't maintain that, and if we allow the water table to rise, there is not enough weight coming down. Okay? So therefore, I think there's a mistake here. Not only the foundations are cast, you have to mobilize enough downward load to take care of the uplift from the water table. So that is the point. The groundwater lowering has to be done by a specialist contractor. This is very specially difficult in case of silts, sandy silts, and silty sands, because the permeability is not enough to be able to lower the water table. There must be 100% standby power for the dewatering system to ensure that the groundwater table is below the bottom of the excavation at all times. Here again, we have given details of some of the projects near Delhi, which we have done on pilot-state draft. All the details are there. No? 17 to 39 floors, 29 to 37 floors, 35 to 38 floors, like that. This is just for sake of completeness, 37 floors, 31 floors, 35 floors. But sometimes if the soil is relatively poor also, you can go for a pile draft, but then that even for less number of floors, you have to do that. For example, you see here at the bottom of Patna, it is only 11 stories, G plus 11. Still, a pile draft was required because the soil strata was relatively poor. So what is the takeaway from this presentation? Pile draft is a very effective and economic solution in most situations for high-rise towers and heavily loaded structures. The reduction in number of piles would be anywhere between 50 to 75% compared to a pile solution, which results in saving of cost and time. Challenge, we need to improve on estimation of soil moduli in case of cohesionless soils and over-consolidated clays. There are, of course, some publications where you can correlate with the N values, which are more reasonable than whatever IS recommendations we have, but they're also slightly on the conservative side. We should carry out many systematic settlement observations on all types of structures to improve our predictions. See, the only proof is settlement observation. There is no other proof. So because there are many problems, if you correlate with N value, and you must have heard, you know, that N values keep on varying for the same strata depending on the type of equipment used for doing SPT tests. Most of our SPT tests are a rope and pulley. You know, for example, four people are pulling the rope and they are supposed to release it at the same time, it's all absurd. So we have been stipulating in all the projects that you have to use only auto drip hammers for SPT. And I understand that the latest IS code also is going to stipulate that auto drip hammers. But even in auto drip hammers, there are so many types. It is always a doubt how reliable it is. Lastly, and most importantly, our geotechnical investigation practices have to reach global standards at the earliest. This has been my passion, the last one. I've been talking in many places and talking to a lot of clients. Actually, I have been saying that the geotechnical investigation agencies, some of them may not agree with this statement. They do not have partly in-house capabilities to make appropriate recommendations. Secondly, they don't have full details of the structures coming up. Thirdly, they do not get any feedback on what type of foundation has been adopted based on their recommendations. So to a very great extent, they are in the dark. So I've been telling the agencies as well as the owners that you get the investigation done only field and laboratory tests to high quality. That is part one. If you wish, then ask for an interpretive report that is part two by the investigation agency, but better is to go for an independent foundation consultant. This is what I have been recommending. So I think more and more people are realizing it, and let us see. This is again the basic requirement for a proper choice of foundation is high quality geotechnical investigation and foundation design. So this is a word of caution, because some of us academicians are required to approve certain designs, especially government projects. And so these agencies, they come for approvals, and then they don't give you enough time, and they bring some insufficient information from the geotechnical investigation and ask for approvals. That is a big challenge, you know. Once you approve, you have a responsibility for it, both morally as well as in reality also. So therefore, word of caution. So I want to acknowledge a very good reference of Professor Harry Paulus, the German publication by Katzenbach and his colleagues. Professor Katzenbach is a professor at Darmstadt, University of Darmstadt, Germany, very outstanding geotechnical engineer. And of course, all our clients who have given us opportunity to come out with new ideas. And they need to have a lot of trust. You know, suddenly, suppose somebody wanted to have a pile foundation like Terminal T3, and then somebody comes and says, no piles are required. Then the implications if the RAF doesn't perform well are huge, you know, unbelievable. So therefore, that is the trust that they have to have. And same thing with high-rise towers. Thank you, and Jai Hind. And I once again admire late Professor Sri Rama Rao for his contributions, and as President of IGS, what he has done. And also thank Dr. Mubal Rama Rao and his colleagues for inviting me to give this talk. And then also, of course, all the people who have participated in this. And then, because especially the youngsters, so you are our future, no? So you have to imbibe all this for past data and also come out with newer ideas. Just like, as I said, 20, 25 years back, there was no pile draft concept. So similarly, I don't know what new concepts will come in the next 10 to 15 years. And as more and more is built, we have to be both safe and economical, because, you know, we cannot also waste so much resources. If you waste a lot of resources in steel and concrete, then it has many other implications. Not only cost, time, and also environmental concern, no? Making steel pollution, making concrete, cement is pollution. So all these issues are involved. So thank you again. I think we have, Professor Rama Rao, we have 15, 20 minutes time, I think, question sir. Answers.
Sir, question so answer now it's session. Open.
Yes.
So question answer session through chat, sir. So now, you can stop your share, sir.
Yes, I'll try that. Yeah. How do I do that? Double click.
Just to stop share is there.
There is on the top, yes.
So participants, I request you, please.
Yes. Yes, please go ahead.
Do not. Participants, now I
request. Shall I switch off my video?
You can use video, sir, because it is a chart. You can. Yeah. So now the participants, I request you send your questions through chat.
Oh, chat, I have to see, no? There is chat.
So bottom, the chat is there. Click the chat, sir.
Yes.
Click the chat, sir.
Yes. Right.
So now I request participants to send questions now, because the questions previous already you have sent.
Yes.
So please send once again now.
Can you, Professor Rama Rao, can you advise in which order I should take these questions?
Because I'm doing
this for the first time. So.
So because they had already sent the questions, I am requesting send the questions now.
Okay.
So, sir, I will read one question. What is the feasibility of pile draft for soils like in Agartala, where N value is 1, in upper 10 to 12 meters?
Not possible. Not possible. You can't use the pile draft for it.
Okay. This is the question from Mr. Abhay Gupta.
I think I can increase the size of this question. I am not able to read. I think. Are you able to still hear me well?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, so, I think it will be nice, Professor Ramarao, if you can read the question.
Okay, okay, sir. I will read, sir. So, one question from Avik Kumar Mandal. What is the effectiveness of the pile draft system in comparison with the pile foundation for the foundation soil having a thick, either loose, cohesionless soil?
Yeah, I think what really happens is
still it is question is there.
Thick, yeah, sorry.
Thick, either loose cohesionless sandy or soft clay silty strata at the top with low bearing capacity value. Will the pile foundation be more suitable instead of a pile draft system there? Please discuss.
No, actually, what really happens is the ideal situation for pile draft is raft by itself can take the load without a shear failure. Only we have to control the settlements. Then a pile raft is an ideal solution. But where the settlements of the raft are very large, you cannot use a pile draft. You have to go for a regular pile foundation.
So this is the question from Mr. Mohan Ramanathan. Thanks for the excellent presentation on this new concept. Pile-assisted raft design is a radical change from the traditional design concept of piles alone to take 100% load and the piled cap or raft for a distribution of the load from superstructure to pile. In this new design philosophy, do you suggest varied length of piles also? Shorter piles in the edges and longer piles in the center? Then what will be the factor of safety in our existing buildings with a large number of piles over large thick rafts? Are we overspending on these foundations? Will the situation change in India?
Mohan, you are absolutely right that we are wasting a lot of money on the foundations in lots of projects. I think my assessment is that in 70-80% of the cases or 90% of the cases, they are maybe over designs. And of course, in some cases, under design, unsafety. You can use varying lengths of the piles. There is no issue at all. You can have longer piles in the center and because you need lesser support for the raft towards the edges. So you can reduce the, either you can reduce the length of the pile or you can increase the spacing of the piles. So either alternative is fine. Whichever is more economical or more feasible. Generally, people prefer the same length of the pile. The reason being that when you do the pile load tests and all that, if you go for different lengths of the piles, maybe you have to do static load tests on large number of piles. On the other hand, if the same length piles are used with increased spacing at the edges and closer spacing at the center, then you don't have to do so many pile load tests. And also, so installation also become standard, but no harm at all. You can always use shorter piles at the edges.
Sir, there is another question from Gurpreet Singh Bhatia. Up to what maximum settlement shall we test the piles of pile draft foundation? Can we adopt to methods of IS 2911 part 4?
No, actually, the ultimate capacity, the safe capacity or the ultimate capacity of the pile, we have to still use IS 2911. Or I think it's 2911. So therefore, you're testing the pile to its ultimate capacity. And to be on the safer side, in our recommendations, we are recommending to use 90% of the ultimate capacity as the load that can be taken by the piles. That means we are still giving a 10% factor of safety there. It's just a judgment because sometimes, there will be variation in the ultimate capacity of the piles. So we test the pile till failure or up to the settlement equal to 10% of the pile diameter.
There is one question from Dr. Anil Cherian, Dubai. do you think that pile head connection rigidity influenced the pile raft foundation?
The piles have to be integrated with the raft as if it is a pile foundation. So therefore, there's no difference in that. It has to be integrally connected. So actually, what happens is, I think this somebody has raised this question also. What happens is, at the top, the piles and the raft will move by the same amount because they are rigidly connected. So, but as you go down, the soil settlements, finally the raft gets its capacity from the soil. So as you go down, the soil settlement, the cumulative soil settlement keep on reducing. But the pile settlement is the same. So therefore, there is a relative displacement between the pile and the soil. So the pile starts mobilizing skin friction and then end bearing. So that, and also because you are transferring the load to the piles at a lower elevation, that is at the end bearing, so then there will be a settlement of the layers below the pile tips. And that has to be added to the pile settlement.
One question from Mr. Anurag Kapoor. Sir, you said in your presentation that 25% load is taken by pile, but general consensus has not been reached on the issue yet as it. Some say it can be 50% each or 40% by pile and 60% by raft. Please give your opinion on this.
You know, it's a design requirement. You suppose, now just let us say, you still want to limit the settlements to 75 mm for some reason, even though the tall structure code has come. If the raft settlements are only coming from, say, let us say 85 mm, then you need to transfer only small percentage of the load to the piles. On the other hand, if the settlements are coming instead of, say, 150 mm, so double than what is permissible, then you have to transfer more than 50% of the load to the piles. So it's not a particular number. So it depends on the raft settlement without the piles. So higher the raft settlements, more load has to go to the piles. If the raft settlements are only marginally higher than the permissible value, only a small percentage of load needs to go to the piles.
Another question, do we have IS standards for pile rafts?
Not yet. That raft, that code has to be developed. So there is one publication by Katzenbach and one of our dear colleagues from IIT Bombay, I think it is Deepankar. They have brought out some publication for the International Society of Soil Mechanics and Foundation Engineering. See, this behavior is quite complex. See, what happens is, if some load is transferred by the raft to the soil, and that will increase the axial stress next to the pile. And then the lateral stress will also increase. So the pile will be able to carry more load. But then if the pile carries more load, then the pile again has to transfer it to the soil. So there's a continuous interaction between the pile and the soil, which is somewhat complex. That's why in major projects abroad, they always insist that the load transferred is directly measured by instrumenting the piles as well as by instrumenting the raft, base of the raft. So below the raft, you can put some pressure pads, and then you know finally when the structure is completed, how much has gone into the piles and how much has gone into the raft.
Sir, one question from Mr. Babu KV. How effective is for lateral load resistance? Friction between the raft and soil can be considered for lateral load in addition to pile lateral load.
If you have, definitely yes, because the lateral resistance is the combination of what gives, what comes by the base of the raft and what comes from the pile capacities. Normally, if you have a good alluvial strata at the base, the displacement required for mobilizing the base friction for the raft, that is at the bottom of the raft, is smaller than the pile displacements. So therefore, more load may go to the raft bottom and less load to the pile, but you can take the combined value. There is no restriction on that. Pile is capable of transferring both vertical load as well as the lateral load.
Another question from Mr. So one question from Ms. Pravallika. What is the difference between pile cap and pile raft?
See, the pile cap is only just, first of all, if you have less number of piles, let us say 3, 4, or 5 piles only, and it's a pile foundation, and then you put a cap on it, and on top of which the column comes. So that is called a pile cap. But if you are having a large number of piles, and all of them are interconnected by a single cap, that is called a raft. And if the design is partly, the load is transferred partly by raft and partly by pile, it's called pile raft. It's only a terminology. See, when it's a pile cap, we don't consider the contribution of the pile cap to load transfer at all. So it's only the piles which are transferring the load.
So there is one question from Dr. Narasingha Rao. How to estimate the load reduction due to negative skin friction on piles? The IS code 2911 is silent on this.
Here, in this particular case, the negative skin friction doesn't come into the picture in the pile raft. So, but in the normal situations, there are standard procedures for estimating the negative skin friction. See, negative skin friction normally comes into picture only if you have compressible layers, and on top of it you put a fill, let's say 2 meter or 2.5 meter fill, and then you have a pile foundation. So in relation to the pile, the soil surrounding may settle. So therefore there is a shear down drag from the soil on the pile. So normally the skin friction is estimated on the basis of the shear parameter between the pile and the raft. Mostly negative skin friction comes from cohesive soils. So you take the shear strength of the soil as acting on the pile and transferring load downwards.
Sir, further questions, I will share your email ID to the participants, sir.
Yes.
So they will send any further questions. Yes. So for the participants, I will share feedback link also, and video of this presentation also I will share you. So I am thankful to Professor V.S. Raju for excellent presentation and question answer session at the end. Now I request Dr. G. Sridevi, Professor HOD Civil Engineering, BVRIT, Narsapur, to give vote of thanks. Madam, so please unmute yourself.
Oh. Respected dignitaries present today, Professor V.S. Raju Garu, Professor G.L. Shivakumar Babu Garu, Professor J.T. Sahu Garu, Engineer Brahmayya Garu, Professor Ramarao Garu, Professor Srinivas Rao Garu, and family members of Professor Sri Ramarao Garu, Niharika Garu, and Madam. A very good afternoon to everyone. Indeed, I am privileged to propose this vote of thanks for this third Professor Sri Ramarao commemorative lecture. I am a student of Professor Sri Ramarao Garu, and as a student, I am really very proud. I am very much grateful to him also, because he is a man of actions and is a great guru who can inspire and ignite the students. I thank the family members of Professor Sri Ramarao Garu for being part of this webinar. Next, I would like to thank Professor V.S. Raju Garu for his excellent presentation on pile raft foundation, their design steps, and the effectiveness of the pile raft foundation. As a professional society, Indian Geotechnical Society, they can contribute for the skill development and also in the process of technological improvement, because as sir, you have rightly pointed out, technology wise and skill wise, we are very much lagging. So professional societies can help in enhancing the skill. And I thank you very much, sir, for your excellent presentation. Then I would like to thank organizers for organizing this commemorative lecture, which is going to help many practicing engineers as well as academicians. And last but not the least, I thank everyone who contributed directly or indirectly for making this event a success. Thank you very much. Thank you, one and all.
So thank you, one and all. So now I declare the webinar is end. So thank you, one and all.
Thank you, and namaste to everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.